Simon & Schuster Audio presents Traveler, Observations from an American in Exile by Michael Katakis. Read by the author. Foreword, written and read by Michael Palin.
Hello, I'm Michael Palin. I've known Michael Katakis for a few years now, ever since he provided invaluable help for a television series I was making on Ernest Hemingway. I've been drawn to Hemingway not just because he'd written boldly and with a fresh voice about the eternal themes of love and war, courage and cowardice, but because he remained, throughout his life, consumed with interest in a world beyond his own country. Through our collaboration, I quickly discovered that Michael and I shared not only a respect for Hemingway, but a respect for Hemingway's thirst for travel. Hemingway, having effected this introduction, left us to get on with it, and for nearly 10 years now, we've been sharing our delight and despair at the wonderful world we live in. I say sharing, and immediately feel somewhat compromised. Michael is a great correspondent, a far better correspondent than I shall ever be. He writes letters, proper letters, composed in pen and ink, from wherever he is in the world, whenever he feels moved to write. Scribbled, perhaps, in a train or at a table after a particularly good meal, Michael's letters exult in discovery. His delight is our delight. Fortunately, he keeps a journal as well. As in his letters, fleeting moments and sudden glimpses are as powerfully evocative as his longer, more considered entries. Nothing is wasted, and nothing is too trivial for him to note, which I think is so important. Once we start censoring what we see, filing it away under weighty or significant, we miss the moment. In both his letters and in his journal, Michael has an infectious ability to sense the essence of a place, whether on the dusty roads of Sierra Leone, in a cafe on the Bosphorus, in a Chinese village without a map, in Dallas, Texas, or on the Paris Metro. He makes a place for us beside him. Michael has two other vital qualities for a good traveller: curiosity and a conscience. I've seen his curiosity in action. He goes up to people, says hello, asks what they're doing and where they're from, and he does it with such charm and obvious good intent that soon he has friends around him like the Pied Piper had children. At the same time, he worries and he cares. Frustration, disillusion and indignation burst out of these pages, undisguised and deeply felt. He loves the world, and he can't bear to see it fall into the hands of those who are out for personal gain at the expense of others. He looks at himself as honestly as he looks at the rest of the world. Learning about people means being prepared to trade your own experience, as he does with a moving and poetic allusion to his mother's death, a fine description of accompanying his father back to the birthplace he hasn't seen for 40 years, or his first delightful feelings on meeting Chris, the woman to whom he has dedicated this book. In short, Traveller contains all the reasons why I value Michael's friendship and the pleasures I've gained from it. Technically, he's enormously gifted. His photographs are peerless. The landscapes have a cool, serene beauty, and his portraits convey joy and dignity in equal measure. He has an open mind and a warm heart. He's always discovering, never presuming, always learning, never preaching, which is why he's worth listening to, and why the implication of his subtitle, Observations from an American in Exile, is both sad and timely. Michael's way of looking at the world is diametrically opposed to those who believe in world domination, whether it be religious, economic, or technological. A book like this, which so vividly celebrates the fine detail of life, makes the casual violence of our times all the more abhorrent and shameful. For me, the message of Traveller, and I'm sure Michael would deny providing anything as clumsy as a message, is that pain and suffering is much less easy to inflict if someone is looking at you. Michael forces us to look people in the face, to remind ourselves that every human life is a mirror of our own. Traveller is the work of a decent, honourable man in a world where the deceitful and dishonourable have far too much influence. If you want to be reassured that the word humanity still means something, this is for you.
Now, Traveller, read by the author Michael Katakis.
For Chris, my true north, and for T.E. Lawrence, who helped a solitary little boy dream of deserts and faraway places. Arriving at each new city, the traveler finds again a past of his that he did not know he had. The foreignness of what you no longer are or no longer possess lies in wait for you in foreign, unpossessed places. Italo Calvino, Invisible Cities. Introduction. Journal entry, 1 October 2005, Istanbul. How could I have known then, with no maps acquired and my bags not yet packed, that my journey had already begun? I am standing on a bank of the Bosporus, watching the meandering river make its way toward the Black Sea. Behind me lay Europe, ahead Asia, and over a period of days now, in this place, memories, my memories, have gently intruded themselves upon me. I remember. The bedroom was not large, though at the time it seemed so. Through Venetian blinds, the sliced summer sunlight made patterns on the bed where my mother lay dying. She was going on a long journey, I was told, so I waited in that room with my mother and with death, wanting to know them before they left. I did not look away. At school, a November morning, and a passing sensation, perhaps that of departure, I ran from the schoolyard, past the Dutch bakery and Chinese laundry, down familiar streets with leafless trees, running, then faster, blurring landscape and a feeling of flight, as in dreams. Past the wagon wheel diner and patio theater, back to the room where the autumn light, diffuse now, made patterns on the bare mattress. The tools of a traveler are compass and map. They calculate distances covered and destinations sought, but cannot measure the consequences of experiences on a human heart. I remember. To the little girl in West Africa with tuberculosis whom I could not save, I think of you often, and I'm sorry. To the Chinese farmer and his family who gave me their bed and laughed at my attempts to plant rice. To the Frenchman on the Pont des Arts who offered me a glass of wine when the war began, and to the South Korean soldier who broke into laughter after tasting a milkshake for the first time. To the angry Palestinian in Chicago, the courageous Muslim woman in France, and the exhausted fireman in St. Paul's Chapel in New York, days after the horror. To the young man with his head in the stars, who I betrayed with the truth, and to my friend, Sar, who protected me and whom I hope has survived the Civil War. Finally, to my dear father, who stayed and whetted my appetite for the world. To all of those, and many more, I owe a debt. If they ever have occasion to read these words and recognize themselves, I hope that they will agree that I kept their trust and my word, and I did not look away. The Importance of a Lie. Journal entry, 18 July 1988, Sierra Leone, West Africa, Kankordu. Sar woke me early to say that someone had come. Half asleep, I walked into the outdoor room to find a fresh pail of river water. I always take time for the morning bucket bath, sometimes luxuriating for too long because it allows me the only time to be alone. This morning, I was annoyed at having to rush. Someone from Kankordu needed or wanted something, I thought, or just wished to sit silent on the veranda, sometimes for hours, visiting in that strange Kono way to which I can never grow accustomed. On the veranda sat a small, nicely dressed man in his 20s, I'd guessed. He rose to greet me with an extended hand and held a large box in the other. He seemed familiar and at first did not speak. I apologized for not having tea, but offered him some filtered water, which he took and drank quickly. I offered more, which he accepted. "Do we know each other?" I asked. "No, but I..." His eyes looked behind me as Chris came out and joined us. He rose again, and I was about to repeat my question when Chris said, "We met in the lorry park in Kwedu, did we not?" "Yes, that is right. We met when you were trying to get transport up country to Kankordu." "You have traveled quite a way," I said. "Is there something we can do for you?" He became nervous and agitated, and after what seemed a long time, Chris began to excuse herself when he quickly and somewhat desperately interrupted. "I have come to ask you questions." With that, he set the large box on the table, opening it carefully so as not to further stress the already broken spine. The contents, which he began to, and there is no other word for it, tenderly remove, were drawings and charts of the stars, as well as old and yellowed newspaper clippings with stories about the American space program. There were stories about Mercury, Apollo, and the names of some astronauts, including John Glenn, which were circled in red. The young man's hand drawings of Saturn and Mars were remarkable, and on some of the pages there were a series of equations that I took to mean latitude and longitude, but could not be sure. He went on, turning page after page. In another place and time, he would have been a student or perhaps a professor of astronomy, I thought. His passion for the subject was startling, and I could see that Chris, too, was amazed by the quality and sheer volume of his writings and drawings. I told him that this was fantastic, but my compliment was either ignored or not heard as he arranged more pages on the table. He then asked me his questions. They were about propulsion systems and temperatures on planets, questions about Halley's Comet and other astronauts' names and how the space program had developed after he had lost track. How far was the end of the galaxy, and how long would it take to reach it? And then questions about the theory of relativity. I was dumbfounded and could only manage a silly, insecure smile in response. And then I made one of the greatest mistakes of my life. I told the truth. I said, "You have studied this so much, and it's amazing, but I'm afraid that you know much more about this than I do. I am learning from you, and I can't answer your questions. I simply don't know." The look on his face cut deep, and in an instant I realized that he had not come for facts at all. He had come for new words to dream by. Perhaps my words would have carried him until August or September, and maybe well past. He might have lay in the tall grass at night staring at the stars, remembering the veranda where we had talked, and ponder what was said. Perhaps he would have fallen into deep sleeps and dreamt of stars, and in those dreams he might have taken flight far from his life of questions with no answers and loneliness. But that was not to be, for I made the terrible mistake of admitting my ignorance and removing myself from our delicate charade. I learned in that moment, when I took everything from him, the importance of lying. Not merely telling an untruth, but lying, with passion and flourish, like an actor on a stage claiming to know that which they do not know. For the lie that keeps hope and dreams intact is preferable to a truth that removes them.
Lies. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.